You're watching ZTV.
You're watching ZTV.
Good afternoon, loved ones. It is Wednesday, July 8th, 2020. I hope you're having a great day. I want to talk to you a little bit today about what I dislike about Christmas, but before I get into that, I want to share a couple things with you. We pray each week for a different assignment as the Lord leads for America. And this week we are praying around the clock for the body of believers to awaken, to become who they are, the ecclesia, and to begin to be the house of prayer for all nations. We really need to be praying. You know, lots of prophetic words and all kinds of things that are going around about there, and some are creating fear, some are not. And if we are praying, we're going to have greater discernment, and we're also going to be hearing from the Lord and be able to know how to respond to things. Hello, Periscope. Thank you for being here. Hello, Facebook. Thank you for being here. Also, so you can go to zm7academy.us and click on prophecy and then go down to intercession, and all of the prayer assignments that we've had since May are all listed there, and you can go and be praying for America. It's really important to be praying for our nation. Not just in this time, but always. You know, that's what the body of believers is supposed to do, is we're supposed to be praying. So lots of fear and stuff like that going around about this being the end times and whatnot. And I drop another end times bonus revelation in that post for today too, calling the church to awaken. So you can get some information there. But if you are reading the Bible and you believe Jesus, he gives you understanding through the word and you know, and communing with him and with Holy Spirit on whether this would actually be the end times or not. You know, and even if you do get a prophetic word that's saying this is the end times, you have to understand that God's not in time, and it's not just this linear, you know, this happened in 2019, this happened in 2020, this happens in 2021. It's not always that kind of a linear progression. You know, the Lord works in cycles. And sometimes things will happen through a prophetic word, through a dream or something like that, and then it'll come back around in a different season, a different cycle, because the Lord is just showing the next generations things that are potentially going to happen. So you have to learn a little bit about how God's time works. And I have a book that I am fixing so that it can be published again called Sanctifying Time, that gives you lots of information about time. In the second chapter, I talk about how, you know, we don't actually know how much time took place between Genesis 1, 2 and Genesis 1, 3, where he says he created the earth, you know, or the Spirit of God was hovering over, and then he went into creation. Like, we don't know exactly God's timeline, right? So a lot of times people say, well, this earth isn't old enough for dinosaurs and all that to have been here millions of years, 10,000 years, whatever it is. Well, we don't know. We don't know what God's timeline actually looked like back then, or even now sometimes, because it says that one day to him is 1,000 years. So if you're trying to wrap your mind around that and trying to figure out, you know, how old the earth is, like, you can make some guesses, but you probably are not going to be able to figure that out, because that's something that, you know, the Lord is the only one who can actually explain what it would actually be like to have 1,000 years and one day being taking place simultaneously. You know, that's something that the human mind can't actually fathom. So that's just some things to think about. And you can order any of my books at supernaturalyoubooks.info. So the next thing I want to talk to you about is, we're speaking about Jesus in our prayer that we're praying tomorrow around the clock for America. So I'm also teaching a course about Jesus. I have videos, and also there's a chapter in my book, My Money Grows on Trees, Sowing into Revelation and Wealth, that talks about this. So sometimes you'll ask the Lord for provision and he'll give you the provision, or he'll give you instructions, like if you're asking for miracle provision. And then sometimes he will give you a strategy, or sometimes he will give you an idea or an assignment, something like that. So a couple days ago, the Lord was like, why don't you teach a class on Jesus so people can get the right idea of who Jesus is? And so I kind of just brushed it off because I do things like that. And then I was praying for my provision. That's one of the things I pray every day. Lord, show me where my provision is for today. And he said, well, I invited you to teach that course. So I was like, oh, okay, I'll teach the course. And that course, it's a survey. It's going to be 3 hours long, but I'll break it up into 30-minute sections because that's a lot. We're going to go through the Bible and just look at who Jesus is. And so that's what my topic is today, is what I dislike about Christmas. And the thing that I dislike about it is that we grow up teaching our kids, you know, about baby Jesus. As believers, we grow up teaching our kids about baby Jesus, and sometimes we don't allow them to mature past baby Jesus into who he actually is. You know, he did come as a baby, but that's not even the most important thing about him coming. The only reason Jesus came as a baby and didn't come down here as a fully grown adult is because that's how humans come into the earth. You know, spirits are released from heaven into wombs. That's how they come into the earth. So if they came into the earth a different way, he would have come to the earth a different way. Him being a baby is not the big deal. It's not the most important bit of information that we need to know, right? So we have to make sure as Christian parents that when we're teaching our kids about baby Jesus, that we don't stop there, that we make sure that we teach our children that Jesus is a full-grown supernatural spirit with power, authority, and all kinds of capabilities and things, and they need to grow up knowing that. You know, there are a lot of people out there in the world who don't understand how powerful he is. There are people out there, you know, the disciples didn't even understand a lot of things about him, and they walked with him physically on the earth for several years. So we want to be sure that when we, if we have young kids and we're getting all excited about Christmas, you know, I don't even do Christmas anymore. I haven't done Christmas for several years now, but if we are I don't have anything against Christmas. Like, you know, other people can celebrate it. I say Merry Christmas, all that good stuff, but I'm like not putting up a tree and not, you know, going crazy Christmas shopping and all of that good stuff. But if you're teaching your kids about Christmas and things like that, you want to be sure that you don't stop at Jesus being the baby. You know, Jesus is the one who said, in my name, you're going to cast out demons, heal the sick, raise the dead, that type of stuff. And the things that he did, we have the capability to do greater because of our covenant relationship with him. So you want to be teaching your kids all of those things. And I know that there are some adults who forget things like that. Jesus knows that there are some adults who forget things like that. And that's why I'm teaching that course. And so that course, if you register for it, it's $35. But if you register by 11:30 a.m. Pacific tomorrow, it's on sale for $7. So it will be a blessing to you. You'll learn a lot about Jesus. You'll come into greater understanding about Jesus. When I wrote the post for what we're praying for tomorrow, I broke down one of the parables that he spoke about, which is found in Luke 19, right? So there's this parable Jesus speaks where he says, there's a wealthy prince who comes and he calls his 10 servants to him and he gives them money and says, I want you to occupy until I come, right? So a lot of times, you know, we read Jesus' parables, but we don't do a lot of study, so we don't actually know what they mean. Well, if you look at that parable and you break it down, the wealthy prince, of course, is Jesus, right? And we know he's the wealthy prince because the prince is the son of the king. And God said when Jesus was baptized, when he came up out of the water, this is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. So that's how we know that the wealthy prince is Jesus. And then the 10 servants, well, why did it have to be 10 servants? Why didn't he call 12 servants since there were 12 apostles or 12 disciples, you know? Well, it's 10 because 10 is the minimum number needed to create a governing body in the Jewish culture, you know, and that you find that back in Genesis. That's why Abraham asked the Lord, you know, well, if you find 50, will you destroy it? And he's like, no, I won't destroy it. And he's like, well, you find 10. He didn't go down below 10 because 10 is the minimum that you need to establish something, right? So then he says he's given them $50,000. Okay, so how many people's bosses give you $50,000 and then tell you to go and do the work, right? Doesn't happen like that in the natural. It happens like that in the kingdom. And that's what Jesus taught about. In the kingdom, he has given us everything we need for life and godliness. In the kingdom, he has his own economic system, his own provisional system, and it doesn't have anything to do with you going to work, you know, for 60, 80 hours to make all this money to buy your house, your car, take care of your kids, put them through college, all of that stuff. God's economy is totally different. I have tons of resources out there that teach you about God's economy, right? If you want to know how to step out of the world's economy into God's economy. And I share all the time because I'm a single mom and I brought my son through everything that I've learned, you know, about the kingdom and everything from my testimony of coming out of homelessness by sowing seed and all of that stuff. So My son is a perfect example. You know, he doesn't have a job. Like, he does some work for me that I pay him for, or, you know, that the for the family, and they pay him and things like that. But he knows how to make money because he understands God's economy, which is sowing and reaping. He knows that if he sows seed, he's going to receive a harvest from that. And so he's able to bring money in to do the things that he wants to do. And this kid gets stuff, you know, by sowing seed, like his $2,500 gaming computer that he got. And, you know, he sowed seed and prayed for that and got that gaming computer. He likes expensive clothes. Like, I am not really a label person. I don't really care about that type of stuff. I'm more of a jeans and t-shirts person, and Adidas is fine with me. He likes expensive clothes like Gucci and all that type of stuff to wear, and he gets that stuff, you know, fancy shoes and all of that stuff, but he gets it by sowing seed. He knows how to sow seed in fertile soil and then receive a harvest from that. That's God's economic system. The believers are supposed to be in that. All believers are supposed to be in that, not just pastors and ministers and people who are running churches and ministries and things like that. And I'm a witness. You know, I do ministry, but I actually run a business. I don't have like that 503C, which, you know, that's for a different reasons, because I don't want those governmental restrictions that a lot of churches are, you know, dealing with right now. And so God's system is different, and he proves this once again in this very short parable, all right? And then he says, invest and put that to work until I return. So what we're supposed to be doing is continually sowing and reaping, sowing and reaping, sowing and reaping, so we can feed the poor, so we can take care of orphans and widows, things like that. God's system is totally different. The Bible says in Proverbs, like, three different places, if you take care of the poor, you take care of orphans and widows, then you will never lack. You know, that's a pretty spectacular promise to receive from the Lord. If you take care of those people who are close to the Lord's heart, who are the poor, the needy, widows and orphans, then God promises to take care of you. That's God's economic system, right? Doesn't say anything in there, you know, about going to work. Yes, you do go to work. You do make money, have a business, whatever it is. But as your actual source, your source is supposed to be God and the kingdom. It's not supposed to be people. You're not supposed to be looking at government as your provision. You're not supposed to be looking at your job as your provision. Jesus, the Father, Yahweh Yireh, is your provision. He is the one who makes it all possible for you, right? So I'm going to be teaching that course, talking about Jesus, letting you know who Jesus is, and just reminding us that, you know, Jesus is coming back as a king. First, he was here as the Savior, right? He sacrificed for us, and sometimes that makes him seem weak, I think, in the eyes of people who are not saved yet. But that was a powerful move that the enemy could not even prepare for. Like I said, otherwise, if they had known the power that was going to come to him and the victory that was going to come to generations after what he did, you know, after that one seed going down into the ground for us, for all of the world, then the enemy would have never crucified him. But because they did, he's able to return in power, and we're able to be restored back to him. So the body of Christ, especially us adults and us leaders in the body, we need to have that mindset about how powerful Jesus is. There's power in his name, power in his blood. You know, we shouldn't be canceling churches and things like that because of a virus. Jesus said that, you know, we can ask the Father anything in his name. If we love him and keep his commandments, we can ask anything in his name and he'll do it for us. You know, if we believe what he says, then we live differently. We act differently. We behave differently. We speak differently. And so we're going to be going over all of that type of stuff in the course. I'm telling you, it's going to be powerful. It's going to be information packed. It's going to be information overload. Even if you try to sit there for that whole 3 hours and watch, you're going to have to come back to it, come back to it, come back to it and study, which is okay, because you'll get new stuff out of it each time. But we are going to take Jesus at his word and honor him and glorify him for who he is. He is not that little baby from the manger. And like I said, that's minor information. It was prophecy fulfilled to prove that he was actually coming. But the thing is, like I said, the only reason he had to come in as a baby was because that's how humans come into the earth, right? If we could be dropped on the earth as full grown adults or even teenagers, God would have dropped him off that way. The only reason he did that is because he had to be fully human so that we could be fully redeemed, fully restored, and he could have full authority on this earth. You don't have a body. If you're not born on this earth as a human in a physical body, you do not have authority here. That's one of the reasons we should not be afraid of any government, any demons, anything, because they don't have bodies. They only have authority here that's been given to them by humans who do have the authority here. You know, these are all things the body of Christ needs to come into understanding and start living out. You know, we've gotta grow up. It's time. It's beyond time. All right. So if you want to pray with us around the clock starting at midnight tonight, go to zm7academy.us, click on prophecy from the menu, and then click on intercession, and the post is there called Awaken. And we're calling the body of Christ. There are some decrees there right out of the word to awaken the body of Christ so that we can be who we're supposed to be. Right. If you're interested in learning more about Jesus Christ, he would love for you to learn more about him. And you don't have to just take the course to learn more about him. I say that in the post also. If you really want to look in Jesus' eyes, just get in the word, you know, with fierce determination, and don't stop eating that word, that bread of life, until your entire being radiates with his presence. That's another way that you can learn. But I have had visitations with him for 3 weeks. I've been praying in tongues for more than 3 hours a day. And that's why I have all of this fire in me. And that's why I've been recording videos a couple times and putting out all kind of stuff. I only put out stuff like this when I've been spending time with the Lord, and then I have all this stuff in me and I have to get it out so I don't go crazy. But you're going to reap the benefit of that in that course. It's going to bless you, truly bless you. So it's $7 until 11:30 a.m. Pacific time tomorrow. You can go to zm7academy.us and register for it. All right. I bless you in Jesus' name. I hope you're doing well. I hope you are not living in fear of this virus. You know, you have nothing to be afraid of with Jesus. I'm telling you, he said that upon the revelation of him being God's son, that he will build his church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Do you realize that the body of Christ cannot be overcome? It cannot be overcome. You don't want to miss church. You don't want to skip out on church. Go to church. Get with other believers. If you are there in agreement, you cannot be overcome. You by yourself cannot be overcome, because you are a member of the body of Christ. And the church is not a building. It's wherever you are. You're the temple of Holy Spirit. You cannot be overcome. The body of Christ cannot be overcome. That's proof that there will be a rapture, right? Because if Satan tried to unleash his fullness while the Holy Spirit here is in us and the body of Christ is here, which cannot be overcome, there's no way he could do all that he wanted to do. The only reason he's wreaking havoc in the earth right now is because we've been allowing it, you know. And I talk about that in the post in our prayer. You know, we have to repent of that stuff, of repeating Jesus's words that there will be wars and rumors of wars, but not repeating his kingdom come, his will be done on earth right now, wherever I am. You know, we say part of what he says, but we don't say the parts with authority. We say the parts that are actually bringing and re-empowering the curse in the earth. That's wrong, right? Jesus doesn't want that for us. He wants us empowered, all right? Again, I bless you in Jesus' name, and I thank you for your time. Take care.